Well, they would have an oldster like myself following these three fabulous kids, but Kirk Reed got to the microphone faster than I could get to the first step over there. So, when I was growing up, my community didn't have very much to read. In fact, we didn't have a community. We only did have a few books, but at least we had a few books. They weren't terribly cheery books, but we did have some. It took until 1982 for this book to come along, this wonderful book for young lesbians. And it is a book that is very precious to my community, is very, very much loved. I sent an email to Nancy Garden in New York last night telling her that I would be reading from her book and how honored I was. And she sends a thank you and love to all of you in San Francisco. Speaking of San Francisco, I would especially like to thank Susan Hildreth and Joan Jasper for putting this program together. There are days I'm very proud to be a San Franciscan, and this happens to be one of them. The scene I'd like to read involves the two young women who are 17 years old in high school. And it's a scene with the two teachers who are lesbians who have been fired when the secret of their relationship, the relationship between the two young girls, comes out into the open. And it's a scene involving these four people. Ms. Stevenson got up and went to the window. Then she stooped and touched the orange cat's nose affectionately through the grating in his carrying case. "Look," she said quietly, "I can't lie to you and say that losing our jobs like this is easy. It isn't. But the point is that it'll be okay. We'll be okay. And we want to know that you will be too." Ms. Widmer leaned forward. "Isabel was a whack for a while," she said, "between high school and college. Someone found some of my letters to her. Talk about inquisitions. The Army's a good deal better at them than Foster High School is, I can assure you. But you know what?" Ms. Widmer smiled lovingly at Ms. Stevenson. "The important thing is," she said, "is that we got through that time too, and we're still together." Ms. Stevenson patted Ms. Widmer's hand, then she came over to me and put her hands on my shoulders. "I should also tell you," she glanced at Ms. Widmer, who nodded, "that Kath almost left me after my discharge. She went through more hell than I did, because she blamed herself for writing those letters to me, even though I was the one who left them around. She kept thinking that if she hadn't written them, if I hadn't been gay," said Ms. Widmer softly, "then nothing would have happened, no court martial, no discharge." "It took me a couple of years to realize," said Ms. Widmer, "that it wasn't my fault, that it wasn't my homosexuality that had gotten Isabel discharged. It was what people wrongly made of it." Annie's hand tightened in mine and she whispered, "See?" "I think," said Ms. Widmer, "that I had to accept I was gay before I could realize that it wasn't my fault about the discharge." She chuckled. "That's why I like that quote so much, the one about the truth making one free. It does, you know, whatever that truth is." And she said, Miss Stevenson said, "Liza, Liza, forget about our jobs. Forget that for now. This is the thing to remember. The very worst thing for Kath and me would be to be separated from each other, or to be so worn down, so guilt-ridden and torn apart that we couldn't stay together. Anything else is just bad," said Miss Widmer, "but no worse than bad. Bad things can always be overcome." "You did nothing to us," Miss Stevenson said gently. If you two remember nothing else from all of this," Miss Widmer said, "please remember that. Please don't. Don't punish yourselves for other people's ignorant reactions to what we all are." "Don't let ignorance win," said Ms. Stevenson. "Let love." Thank you.